Investors in publicly traded companies have the luxury of knowing the value of their investment at virtually any time. An internet connection and a few clicks of a mouse are all it takes to get an up-to-date stock quote. Of all US companies, however, less than 1% are publicly traded, meaning that the vast majority of companies are privately held. Investors in privately held companies do not have such a readily available value for their ownership interests. How are values of privately held businesses determined then? The income approach is one of the three approaches used to estimate firm and equity value. The income approach seeks to identify the future economic benefits to be generated by an entity and to compare them with the required rate of return. The income approach is widely recognized. It is flexible in addressing companies of many different stages and natures, and it simulates a market price even if there is no active market. A critique of the income approach is that it relies on hypothetical projections and utilizes a discount rate with many variables in determining the appropriate figure. There are multiple methods within the income approach, the discounted cash flow method being the most widely known one. In this section, we will learn about all facets of the income approach along with some do's and don'ts and, as usual, some expert advice. In this session, you will learn about income approach, which includes discounted cash flow analysis, discount rate, weighted average cost of capital, beta. The methods of calculating DCF, such as free cash flows to firm, free cash flow to equity, and then assets not to be included in the DCF valuation, how to arrive at the terminal value using the Gordon growth model and the exit multiple approach. We will also learn about the common errors in the income approach, such as mismatching cash flows and discount rates, incorrect assumptions, errors in terminal value, and some other generic errors. So let's begin. Let's begin with the basics of the income approach. The income approach involves valuation methods that convert future anticipated economic benefits in terms of cash flows into a single present value rupee or dollar amount. Future anticipated economic benefits are defined in terms of cash flows, and depending on the method chosen, the cash flow used may be a free cash flow to firm, that is cash flows available to all providers of finance, both equity and debt, or free cash flows to equity, that is cash flows available to providers of equity after debt providers have been paid. As many of you must be aware, since this is a cash flow model, the approach is referred to as the discounted cash flow approach. In simple terms, DCF analysis attempts to value a project, company, or asset today based on how much money it is projected to make in the future, with the idea that the value is inherently contingent on its ability to generate cash flows for investors. For example, if you estimate a stock is worth $50 based on your DCF analysis and it's currently trading at $30, you know the stock is undervalued. DCF is not limited to just valuing a company. It can be used to value a division of a company, a project, or an asset. Basically, DCF can be used for any firm that generates a cash flow. The discounted cash flow or DCF approach has its foundation in the present value rule, where the value of any asset is the present value of the expected future cash flows that the asset generates. The value is arrived at when those cash flows are discounted or present valued at a discount rate that represents the risk of those cash flows. The cash flows will vary from asset to asset. Dividends for stocks, coupons or interest, and the face value for bonds, and after-tax cash flows for a real project. The discount rate will be a function of the riskiness of the estimated cash flows, with higher rates for riskier assets and lower rates for safer projects. The DCF method is the most scientific among all the valuation methods in terms of conceptual framework. The income approach determines the value of a business based on its income potential. It looks at cash flows. In doing so, it does not place value on the fixed assets of the business alone, but on their cash-generating capability. This valuation method is best suited for solid cash-generating businesses, that is, businesses that are not asset-intensive and ones that may not be profitable today but have great growth potential. The method is also useful for companies whose future performance is expected to be significantly different from historical performance on account of known factors such as expansion, new products or services, potential acquisitions, or other similar events. While using the income approach, it is also important that the company has strong visibility on its future performance, at least for a few years. say 3 to 5 years. Without such visibility, the method could throw up valuations that are completely misleading. The discounted cash flows method, which is based on estimating the current value of future cash flows, is hence appropriate for businesses which are based on cash flows and not book profits. The income approach is generally used where companies have reliable long-term forecasts. It is also applied in some cases where there is no business history as the entity is completely new. It is particularly applicable in three scenarios. DCF is used in startup businesses where only a DCF can effectively measure the value, as it takes into account the negative cash flows in the initial years and then the positive cash flows in later years. Limited life businesses such as mining projects also use the DCF methodology, as the DCF only includes the cash flows for the remaining life, whereas the market approach generally and theoretically capitalizes earnings into perpetuity. Also, underperforming or loss-making businesses prefer the DCF method because DCF can capture the turnaround that may be realized over the next few years, as well as the risks and sensitivities. It incorporates all the factors relevant to the business, like tangible and intangible assets, current and future competitive position, financial and business risks, etc. This method is applicable for under-construction assets where there is no track record of earnings. In addition, it is also applicable for operating companies which have definite agreement periods or life, such as roads, ports, mines, etc. The elements of a basic DCF analysis are the weighted average cost of capital, also known as WACC, free cash flows, terminal value, firm value, and equity value. When we are dealing with DCF, we should have an estimate of the current cash flows on the investment, be it dividend or interest or coupon, the free cash flows to the equity holders only or to the firm as applicable, depending on which cash flows are used, the current cost of equity or capital on the investment, the expected growth rate in earnings based upon historical growth, and the analyst's forecasts or fundamentals for the company's future growth. When we are dealing with DCF, we should have an estimate of the current cash flows on the investment, be it dividend or interest or coupons, the free cash flows to the equity holders or the firm, depending on which cash flows are used, the current cost of equity or capital on the investment, the expected growth rate in earnings based upon historical growth, and the analyst's forecast or fundamentals for the company's future growth. As you can see in the flow chart, one can decide which type of cash flow to discount depending on whether it is for only the equity holders, that is equity valuation models, or both the debt and equity holders together, in which case we use firm valuation models. On the basis of this discretion, the discount rate will also be estimated. If it is an equity valuation model, then the cost of equity will be used as the discount rate, while if it is a firm valuation model, then the weighted average cost of capital will be used as the discount rate. We will come to that shortly. Another decision has to be made based on the earnings of the company as current or normal type to be incorporated in the analysis. This means assessing whether the current earnings are normalized, stable, and maintainable, or are there expected future events that may change the earning levels. Finally, the important step in the DCF process is the growth stage of the model. Here too, one can distinguish between stable, two-stage, or a three-stage model and execute the calculations accordingly. Let's get into more details of each of these methods of DCF analysis. The discount rate applied varies depending on the type of cash flows being used and the valuation required. If the valuation is based on free cash flows to equity or equity value, which calculates value of the business only for the equity holders, that is after all outside liabilities have been paid off, then the cost of equity is used as the discount rate. When arriving at the valuation based on free cash flows to the firm or FCFF or firm value, which computes value for both debt and equity holders, the discount rate used is the weighted average cost of capital or WACC. Moving on to weighted average cost of capital, this is the blended cost of equity and debt capital of the entity. The cost of equity is the return required by equity holders for the risk of investing their capital into the company, while similarly the cost of debt is the return required by debt holders. However, because debt interest is tax deductible, the cost of debt required is effectively the after-tax cost of debt, that is interest rate, into 1 minus the tax rate. The blended value is based on the portion of equity and debt in the entity's capitalization. The post-tax WACC to be used in DCF calculations to arrive at firm value is commonly calculated as per the equation shown on your screen, where WACC is equal to post-tax weighted average cost of capital. Here, RE is the required rate of return on equity capital, E is the market value of equity capital, D is the market value of debt, RD is the required rate of return on debt capital, and TC is the statutory corporate tax rate for the country in which the business operates. In the WACC calculation, we can see the RE is called the cost of equity capital, which is based on a model called the Capital Asset Pricing Model, or CAPM, or CAPM. The Capital Asset Pricing Model is a model for estimating the rate of return required by an equity investor. Under the CAPM, the required rate of return on equity is calculated as shown on your screen, where RE is the rate of return on equity, RF is the risk-free rate of return, BE is the expected equity beta of the investment, RM is the expected rate of return on the market portfolio of risky investments, and RM minus RF is the market risk premium. By this definition, as per the CAPM, the return on equity required is the risk-free rate plus the equity beta multiplied by the market risk premium. Finally, another key concept in the income approach is the terminal value. Since a business is valued as a going concern, it is assumed to continue forever. Now, it is obviously not possible to project business performance forever. So usually, after a reasonable horizon of 3 or 5 years, a terminal value is computed, which captures the value of the business into perpetuity. This is computed using the Gordon growth model or an exit multiple. Beginning with the Gordon growth model, this model is typically used to determine the intrinsic value of a stock based on a future series of dividends that grow at a constant rate. Given a dividend per share that is payable in 1 year and the assumption the dividend grows at a constant rate in perpetuity, the model solves for the present value of the infinite series of future dividends. This approach, when applied in the DCF to value a business, considers a certain cash flow to grow at a constant rate into perpetuity and solves for the present value of such a stream of cash flows. Once you have decided at what point the terminal value is to be computed, let's say for instance year 5, then the terminal value as per Gordon growth model would be computed as follows. The terminal value is equal to year 5 cash flows multiplied by 1 plus the growth rate divided by the return on equity minus G. So let's see each of these terms in detail. Your Y5 into 1 plus G represents a stream of cash flows that will continue to grow forever at a stable rate. G represents long-term stable growth rate assumption, and RE is the cost of equity as computed for the discount rate. If applying an exit multiple, then the cash flows of year 5 are simply multiplied by a multiple, which could be an EV by EBITDA or a price to cash flows, which we will understand better when we discuss the market approach. The resultant terminal value under either approach should be discounted similar to the year 5 cash flows, since it represents a perpetual cash flow stream from year 6 onwards. Remember that for finite lived businesses, such as the 30-year contract to construct and operate a road or a 15-year power supply contract, cash flows for the finite period should be plotted and no terminal value should be considered, since such projects are not expected to continue forever. Another key term you should be familiar with in DCF analysis is beta. Beta is a measure of the sensitivity of the movement of the company's stock price to the stock market in general. A beta of 1 means that the company's price moves in exact correlation with the market. A beta of 1.3 means that 1% movement in the market causes a 1.3% movement in the company's stock price. Beta measures are derived using regression analysis on the company's stock price, sampled by daily, weekly, or monthly basis over a given time period. Now we will discuss some common queries related to the income approach, such as which items to be included and which ones excluded, the cash flow should start from which line item, etc. Typically, a DCF process starts with the operating earnings of the entity. For a company, this is mostly the EBIT line. The rationale here is that the cash flows should derive from the operations of the company. The free cash flows should also be unlevered, that is, they do not reflect the interest costs of debt or leverage. The free cash flows should be the amount before any dividends are subtracted out for the equity holders. Since EBIT is after depreciation, and depreciation or amortization are non-cash items, this should be added back in the calculations. In fact, all non-cash items that may have been deducted should be added back, since the DCF is a pure cash flow approach. These cash flows then need to be adjusted for tax, projected capital expenditures and projected working capital requirements to arrive at the net free cash flows for each period that are available to all providers of finance, that is before debt providers are paid. An important note here, the tax to be considered when using a free cash flows to firm approach needs to be adjusted for the tax shield or benefit that leverage provides. Basically, a company that has debt needs to pay interest. Therefore, the earnings before tax or EBT of a company having debt would be lower than a company not having any debt, and accordingly, the leveraged company would pay lower tax. Since FCFF is based on the principle of calculating value irrespective of financing pattern, no benefit of leverage should be considered on the cash flows. And hence, instead of taking the tax as per income statement, tax for the purpose of DCF is computed on the EBIT and reduced. It is pertinent to note that the FCFF does not consider any debt or interest related cash flows. So the formula for free cash flows to the firm is EBIT into 1 minus tax rate, which is the post-tax EBIT, plus depreciation or amortization, minus projected capital expenditures, plus or minus the projected working capital needs. A very important part of this process is the treatment of cash and related assets. The simplest and most direct way of dealing with cash and marketable securities is to keep it out of the valuation. And hence, the cash flows should be before interest income from cash and securities, and the discount rate should not be contaminated by the inclusion of cash. The cleanest way to value cash is to keep it separate and value it separately from operating assets. In firm valuation, we tend to do this because we use operating income to estimate cash flows. In equity valuation, we tend to incorporate cash into the income and the value because we start with net income. Once the operating assets have been valued as per the FCFF, you should add back the value of cash and marketable securities. This was the calculation of free cash flows to the firm or FCFF. When looking at the free cash flows to equity, we arrive at the cash flows that are available only to equity shareholders. So the FCFF needs to be adjusted for payouts to providers of debt, which is both interest and repayments. The tax here would be the actual tax as per income statement, since the tax shield on interest would be available. The formula for FCFE is EBIT plus depreciation or amortization minus interest minus tax minus projected capital expenditures plus or minus projected working capital needs plus or minus change in investments and plus or minus movements in debt. The cash flows represent all the cash available to equity shareholders. Since dividends are for equity holders, they should not be deducted from these cash flows. In this case, cash and cash equivalents need not be added separately at the end, as they are considered as contributing to the cash flows and included in the FCFE itself. Now that we have understood both types of cash flows, it is important to iterate that the FCFF is discounted at WACC and FCFE is discounted at cost of equity. Let's look at the assets that should not be counted in the income approach. If an asset is contributing to your cash flows, you cannot count the market value of the asset in your value. Thus, you should not be counting the real estate on which your offices stand, the property, plant and equipment representing your factories and other productive assets, any values attached to the brand names or customer lists, and definitely no non-assets such as goodwill. The logic here is that the benefit of this asset is already incorporated into your cash flows, and adding their market value would double count them. Market values of assets are only relevant if they are intended to be sold or do not contribute to the future operating cash flows of the business. Which brings us to the second point here, that is the assets that you can count or add on to your DCF valuation. They are the unutilized assets. If you have assets or property that are not being utilized to generate cash flows, vacant land, for example, you have not valued it yet. You can assess a market value for these assets and add them on to the value of the firm. Coming to the practical difficulties that may be faced under this approach, forecasting future cash flows is not easy or very objective in many cases due to industry or company factors. Also, finding appropriate discount rates in Indian market conditions may not be a wholly objective exercise in many cases, as it is dependent on a lot of factors. After discussing the income approach of valuation in detail, let's look at some of the common errors in applying the income approach. Because just like applying the right valuation approach is important, keeping the model error-free is also critical, otherwise the entire exercise would lead to a wrong value. Some of the most common errors are mismatching cash flows and discount rates, incorrect assumptions, errors in the terminal value, as well as some other errors. Let's understand mismatching cash flows and discount rates. One should always be sure that the discount rate is prepared on the same basis as the cash flows. This cannot be overemphasized. As explained earlier, in cases of equity valuation, the cash flows should be after interest and debt payments, and the cost of equity should be considered as the discount rate. For firm valuation, the cash flows should be prior to any interest or debt payments, and the WACC should be used as the discount rate. The tax treatment should be done carefully to avoid errors in the terminal value. When using the FCFF for firm valuation, remember to add back the tax shield on interest, that is, interest into the tax rate. Since you are starting with EBIT and evaluating cash flows for a company that is neutral to debt or equity. Also, the correct earnings should be selected for building the cash flows. Check whether the earnings are real or nominal and consider any inflation impact appropriately in the cash flows and the discount rate. If the cash flows being discounted are nominal cash flows, that is, they reflect expected inflation, the discount rate should also be nominal. Moving on, inadequate understanding of assumptions underlying the business plan results in a valuation which is not grounded in reality. Sometimes the business plan is over-optimistic from the seller or business owner's side, and so one should check trends like, can the projected high revenue growth be achieved indefinitely? And question unjustifiable margin expansion by checking whether the revenues can continue to outgrow expenses. When building the discount rate, one should check that it reflects all the risk factors involved, like currency risk, solvency risk, etc. Errors in the terminal value is another common error in the DCF valuation. The cash flow used to compute the terminal value should be looked into carefully. If it is not representative of a stable long-term cash flow, then the valuation could go grossly wrong. Terminal value should be applied to the DCF calculation only in the period when cash flows have stabilized, since the terminal value calculation is a capitalization of cash flows which automatically assumes that the cash flows of that period can be sustained with normal growth into perpetuity. So if there are any abnormal growth events that are anticipated after the terminal period, then the terminal value would not capture those and the valuation would be wrong. Sometimes the long-term growth rate is too high and the reason behind the same should be properly scrutinized. Normally, the long-term growth rate used to compute the terminal value should more or less correspond to general inflation. Depreciation and capex are important while building the free cash flows and should reasonably approximate in the final year used to calculate the terminal value. This is because once stable operations are achieved, the presumption is that one-time large capital investments would not be required and capex would mostly represent maintenance and replacement expenditure. We conclude with some other errors. Sometimes the change in working capital is not consistent with sales growth assumptions. One needs to check the flow. Can sales be grown without an increase in inventory? Is the capex too low for forecast sales and earnings growth? And whether the incremental return on incremental capital invested is realistic or not? Whether the incremental return on incremental capital invested is realistic or not? Since the kind of decisions made on the basis of the valuation are generally very crucial and important in nature, it is very essential for the model to be accurate in all respects, because even a small error can lead to large impacts for the entity involved. That's it for now. We hope you found the session insightful.